In this session, we'll be talking about working with matrices, different matrices related calculations, and the calculus, especially doing some kind of differentiation or doing some kind of integration, right? Some of the areas which generally we are all people who don't have a background in calculus, they'll definitely have a tough time in understanding these concepts. But now with R, all these are getting more and more simplified. Right? So let's try to look at a few important aspects which play a lot of important role in the world of analytics. Right? Or even today in the financial world. Right, it is becoming very, very important that I understand the concept of matrices heavily. I also need to understand the concept of differentiation, integration. So some kind of calculus understanding is also very much an essential thing to understand various concepts in finance and business analytics. But of course, doing them using a pen and paper could be more of a difficulty. So this is where sometimes by using a tool like R, we can even go ahead in terms of doing these computations as well. So in this session, my focus is trying to understand in what all cases I can use the various features of R to do some kind of functions associated with a matrix, especially if I have to find the determinant of a matrix, a 2x2 matrix, 3x3 matrix. Right, if I want to find out the determinant of that particular matrix, of course, we have a theoretical way of doing it. But yes, I have a ready-made formula that is available in R, which can find out the determinant of a matrix. I have to use the inverse of a matrix. There are so many applications in the practical world where a matrix inverse is very much used, especially if I have to solve linear equations. Right, solve simultaneous linear equations for x and y. The inverse of matrix comes in very, very handy. But of course, if I have to do it manually, it takes too much of a time. And probably they are all error prone. So this is where if I am learning mathematics, especially the matrices using a tool like R, really simplifies my understanding. As a business user, as a functional user, if I am able to understand the functional aspect of why a matrix is used, when a matrix need to be used, how a matrix need to be used, the tool will take care of the remaining part for me. Similarly, there are so many applications of eigenvalues and eigenvectors, right? We use in our business analytics, we use something called principal component analysis. We use something called factor analysis, which are purely based on the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So how do I really compute those kind of eigenvalues and eigenvectors in R, which will simplify my understanding? If I just understand the business meaning of eigenvalue and eigenvector, that would simplify. I really don't need to go ahead in terms of simplifying the problems to find out my eigenvalues, eigenvectors. If I understand the business significance of them, that should be more than sufficient for me. And we are talking about solving a system of linear equations using matrices. Right? If I have to solve multiple linear equations, how can I use matrices to solve them? We have ready-made formulas for doing all these kinds of aspects. And towards the end, I'm going to spend some time in terms of how do I really use differentiation and integration in the concept, in the context of R? So going ahead, trying to understand in R, when we talk about the basic representation, if something has to be represented in the form of a matrix, I'll simply use matrix command, right? So let me quickly get used to it. Let's say I'll say a matrix A. I'll simply take it as a matrix. Let me take just for example 1 to 9 serial numbers. Right, I'm taking 9 values 1 to 9 and I'm setting them n row equal to 3. Means I require number of rows equal to 3. So it becomes a 3x3 matrix. when I am setting n row equal to 3, it becomes a 3 by 3 matrix. And in this case, if I am typing A, this is how I get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. By default, the whatever are the numbers that I am providing, they get entered in the columns. But if I say it has to enter row wise, then I have to add one more additional parameter, by row equal to true. Now when I am doing A, I will get the values entered row wise. So I have to really decide, I have to see by default, whatever is the order that I am providing, whatever the order in which I am providing the data, should it be entered in the form of columns or should it be entered in the form of rows? But I don't think that would be really a serious problem, because I can take T of A, which is called as a transpose. Right, T is a small t is a function which actually computes the transpose of a matrix. Transpose, I think we are all comfortable. The row becomes column, the column becomes rows. So even if it is entered in the form of columns or in the form of rows, I can very well change it to the other form by simply doing a T function. Now, when we have two matrices, right, let's say I am having the matrix A, which is 1 to 9, right, I already have my A, so this is my A, I'll have one more matrix B, which is, I'll take the numbers, probably let me take it in a different way, right, I'll enter the numbers 5, 2, 1, 8, 4, 3, 9, 2, 7. So I'm entering some 7, 9 different values. So this also I am setting n row equal to 3. So this is also another 3 by 3 matrix. So the B is this kind of a 3 by 3 matrix. A is that 1 to 9 kind of a 3 by 3 matrix. Now if I really want to multiply these two matrices, matrix multiplication. If you remember the matrix multiplication, if I am talking about something like this. This is one matrix, right? The other matrix I am putting in K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S. So basically what happens is the first row of the first matrix is multiplied with the first column and then a sum product. So it becomes, the first term will become A, K plus B, N plus C, Q. Then the first row will be multiplied with the second column of the second matrix. So the second term will become AL plus BO plus CR, so on. So that's how the matrix multiplication happens. So it becomes a very painful aspect when we are doing it in a manual way. It's just a time killing aspect, because at the end the multiplication will have some kind of a meaning. Right, in finance world I can use this kind of multiplications towards the computations in the variance of a portfolio. There are so many applications, but I am just giving one such kind of an application, computing the variance of a portfolio where I may have to require doing a matrix multiplication. So that is where I can simply take in a simple symbol like this, percentage star percentage will do a matrix multiplication. So when I say, okay, let me do two things. I do a A multiplied by B, then you see what happens. If I am doing A multiplied by B, it's a element to element multiplication. The first element of A is multiplied with the first element of B, 1 into 5. Second element of A multiplied with the second element of B, 2 into 8, 16. Third element of A multiplied with the third element of B, 3 9s 27. So this is what happens when I am simply doing A into B, which is a regular multiplication. So it's an element by element kind of a multiplication. But in a matrix multiplication, I don't want that way. As we said, the first row of the matrix will be multiplied with the first column of the second matrix, and after that the things would be summed up. So that's where I'll use A percentage star percentage B. So in this case, this is how it works out. So it's as good as saying 1 multiplied by 5, 5 plus 4 multiplied by 2, 8 plus 5, 13 plus 7 multiplied by 1, 7. So that is how the, okay, this is my A, right? This is my A. So A multiplied by B. So this is my first row multiplied by the first column. 1 into 5 plus 2 into 2 plus 3 into 1, which is making it 12. Similarly, 1 into 8, 8 plus 2 into 5, 10, 18 plus 3 into 3, 9, 27. So that is what is becoming this particular term, 27. So this is what is happening when you are doing a matrix multiplied with B. The same logic I can do with B multiplied by A. So if I am comfortable with the concept, I really don't need to do this manually, because I am able to use R, or for that matter many other tools, to typically perform these calculations. But here we can very clearly understand that A multiplied by B is not the same as B multiplied by A when we are doing a matrix multiplication. Then another important aspect that comes up in terms of understanding here is the diagonals of a matrix. So when I am simply looking at the diagonals, initially I can set the diagonals, right, depending on the size of the matrix. I want a 3 by 3 matrix, so I can simply fill in the diagonals with one particular value, and after that I can very well edit those values as well. So if you see, I want to create a diagonal matrix, I'll simply say diagonal, or probably a diagonal matrix, I'll give a name to it, I'll hold it. So I'll say diagonal 1, 3, 3, means it's a 3 by 3 matrix, and I'm setting the diagonal values as 1. That's the initial setting part for the diagonal. So when I'm looking at DM, it shows me 1, 1, 1. Now I can edit the same by editing the diagonal of DM. I'm editing the diagonals of DM. I'm trying to set them with some other values. Let's say I want them as 4, 8, 2. So now if I'm looking at DM, they become, the diagonals are becoming 4, 8, 2. Now similarly, when I'm extracting, if I want to extract the diagonals, I'll say diag DM, where I'll get them as vectors 4, 8, 2. So from any kind of a matrix, I can just extract the diagonals, because here, generally in finance, we are using something called variance covariance matrix. So variances are always on the diagonals, and the covariances are the other element. So if I want to extract the variances of the various securities, I can very well use diag DM, which will extract only the variances part. So this is where I can very well use the diagonals as an application. Then, the determinant of a matrix. Generally, just a quick theoretical upgrade for the determinant. If I'm talking about a 2 by 2 matrix, the determinant of it is a one single number, right, which is generally computed as AD minus BC. The determinant represented with the modulus. The determinant of a matrix, if it is a second order matrix, the determinant is nothing but AD minus BC. Whereas in the third order kind of stuff, so we are starting with one of them. So A11 multiplied by the determinant of this, we will alter the signs. Minus A12 multiplied by the determinant of the remaining two columns, plus A13 multiplied by the determinant of these three. So I have to find out the determinant of this, I have to find out the determinant of this and determinant, and after that multiply it with its adjoining factors, which will typically compute my overall determinant of the matrix. But here it's very simple, I'll simply use a function called det A, which will compute the determinant. In this case, it looks like the determinant of matrix A is 0 because you see it is just a rounded step into 10 to the power of minus 16. So basically it is rounded to 0. Similarly, if I am trying to find out the determinant of matrix B, it is 58. So that's how I can quickly compute the determinant of the matrix. Now, if you see any row or a column of a determinant is multiplied by a scalar, the value of the determinant also is multiplied by lambda. Let's do one thing, right? Let me multiply my B. So this is my B, right? So what I'll do is I'll take B1, where I'll just change the first row or the first column. So I'll just double them. So let me take matrix. Instead of 5, I'll take it as 10. Instead of 2, I'll take 4. Instead of 1, I'll take 2. Rest all, I'll keep them as it is. 8, 5, 3, 9, 2, 7. So in this process, what is that I have done? The first column, 5, 2, 1, I have made them 10, 4, 2. That's the only thing. All other values, I have retained them as it is. And I have created a new matrix, B1. Look at the determinant of B1. You will find that the determinant is exactly double. So some of the rules. The originally the determinant was 58. Now the determinant became 116. So if any one single row is multiplied with a scalar, you will find that the determinant also is multiplied with that same scalar lambda. If all the elements of a row or column are 0, if one column or one row is fully 0, you will find that the determinant will be 0. Or if you can express one as a linear combination of the other. Now if you see in this case, why did the determinant here become 0? If I take subtractions, 2 minus 1, right, I can very well set R2, I will replace it with R2 minus R1. R3, I will replace it with R3 minus R2. So this becomes 4 minus 1, 3, 5 minus 2, 3, 6 minus 3, 3. So this is becoming 3, 3, 3. This also is becoming 3, 3, 3, which means both the rows are exactly the same. If they are exactly same or exactly the same multiples, then I could typically see that the determinant of that matrix will be 0 itself. So that's the reason you could see in this case the determinant came out to be 0. Of course, these are all the theoretical aspects of finding the determinant. But when we are looking at it from a practical standpoint, you can directly put the matrix and you can find out whether the determinant of it is 0 or not. Because in R, it's a ready-made feature that is available. Function that is available where you can find out the determinant of the matrix. So if the determinant is not equal to 0, then I cannot put any kind of dependency between the rows or the columns. Whereas if the determinant is coming out to be 0, like in the case of matrix A, I can see some level of relationship, interdependency that is existing between the columns or rows of A matrix. That's one more thing you have to be comfortable with. The moment I am seeing that the determinant is working out to be 0, I should be able to establish some kind of a relationship between the rows or between the columns of the matrix. If at all the determinant is not coming out to be 0, I can safely assume that there is a layer of independence that is existing between the columns of the matrix. Alright. Now, when the other important aspect which has a lot of practical significance with respect to matrices is finding out the inverse. We have a matrix multiplication in general, which we have already seen the application wise, but we generally don't have matrix division. But what we generally use is finding out the inverse of a matrix. Especially for the square matrix. So n by n kind of a matrix is what we are calling as a square matrix, whose determinant is not equal to 0. So in our example, the matrix A is having the determinant of 0. So I cannot really find out the inverse of that matrix. But for matrix B, the determinant is not 0. We got it as 58. I can very well find out the inverse of that particular matrix. And the inverse means if I am multiplying the inverse of the matrix with the original matrix, it should be equal to the identity matrix. Identity matrix is nothing but it will have 1 along the diagonals and all other values will be 0. This is what is my identity matrix. So the way I compute the inverse of a matrix, theoretically if I have to do, I will have to find out the adjacent values of the matrix, right? I need the cofactors, which is what we are denoting as HA. Adjoint matrix is what we are typically calling as. So I am getting the cofactors, adjoining matrix associated with the cofactors of A divided by the determinant of A. That is the way when we are doing it in a pen and paper way, we are finding out the inverse of the matrix. But here I can directly use a simple function called GINV from the mass package. So mass is already installed as a part of the default itself. So if not, you can install the package, after that load it. So the mass package is loaded with library function. Now I can use my GINV function. Now if you look at GINV of matrix A, it gives something, because obviously we have got exactly not zero. The determinant which has been found out by R, it's not a perfect zero. So that's the reason it is doing some kind of an alteration and it is computing the inverse of a matrix. But of course, in real world, the inverse for these kind of matrices do not exist. Right? If the determinant is zero, the inverse for this matrix does not exist. The same logic I can do with G inverse B, which is computing the matrix inverse for B, which is coming out as 0.5. Right, minus 0.5, minus 0.5, minus 0.2. So this is exactly the same as I find the determinant of the matrix, I find the adjoint factors of the matrix, I divide them, I will end up with this particular matrix itself. So it is simplifying our calculations, it is removing the impact of manual errors that can crop up while doing the matrix computation. So understanding this kind of computations of the inverse. So here we can restrict ourselves to typically the business significance of the inverse. Right, wherever we come across the necessity that I have to find the inverse of a matrix, I don't really need to go panic on how do I really compute the same. The tools today are doing the job for us. So there's a lot of mathematics, lot of statistics that can very well be learned, not through the pen and paper way, but primarily through the usage of tools. It's only the functional significance that I need to understand. One more important aspect of matrix, which has a lot of practical applications, is the computation of the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. You have lots of applications with respect to principal component analysis, factor analysis, lot of dimension reduction related problems in statistics. We will be using the concept of eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So the concept is very simple. We are having a square matrix A and we are talking about two column vectors X and K, right? So basically it is like I have a matrix A, which is, let's say, ABCD. It's a square matrix, 2 by 2 matrix. I'm having a column vector X, right? So I'll call it as X1, X2. The product of these two things is typically equal to my B1, B2. So this is basically nothing but I'm trying to, if you try to look at it, this is nothing but a system of simultaneous equations. If you do the multiplication, AX1 plus BX2 equal to B1, CX1 plus the DX2 equal to B2. So we are having two simultaneous equations like this. We can very well express it in this form. And now I am trying to find out one particular scalar multiple lambda in such a way that Ax equal to lambda x, right? So I am trying to find out a scalar multiple in such a way that Ax is equal to lambda x, which is nothing but I can very well write it as Ax minus lambda x equal to 0, which otherwise becomes A minus lambda times I times x is equal to 0. So this is what we are typically calling as, this scalar multiple lambda, which will make the determinants equal to 0, are typically called as my eigenvalues. The solution is possible when the determinant of A minus lambda I is 0. So we are getting an nth degree equation in lambdas, and that nth degree equation in lambda is typically called as a characteristic equation. And the roots of that nth degree equation that I am getting, they are called as eigenvalues. So basically I am solving for that nth degree equation, right? So wherein I am trying to set, if Ax equal to B, I am talking about in such a way, I take that particular lambda, Ax will become equal to lambda x. So basically it is like A, B, C, D times x1, x2 should be equal to some k times x1, x2. So I am trying to find out these values of k, where A, B, C, D times x1 and x2 become k times x1 and x2. So this is what we are trying to set, or probably lambda here, lambda times x1 and x2. And what if you look at it, the way we are trying to find this out, even if it is in a physical form, if you have to find it out, it is nothing but Ax1 plus Bx1 is equal to lambda x1, sorry, Bx2 is equal to lambda x1, Cx1 plus Dx2 equal to lambda x2. I want it this way. So basically it is like Bx2 is becoming lambda minus A times x1, and at the same time, so I can very well find out my lambda from this particular values. So similarly, it is becoming Cx1 is typically becoming lambda minus D times x2. Now in place of x2, I can very well substitute Cx1 by lambda minus D. So it becomes B into Cx1 by lambda minus D is equal to lambda minus A into x1. So if you can try to simplify the same, it becomes BCX1 is equal to lambda minus A. So lambda squared minus AD lambda plus AD, or A plus D lambda plus AD times x1. So if I am taking out x1, it is becoming lambda squared minus of A plus D lambda plus AD equal to BC. So from here I can very well solve the values of lambda. So these typical values of lambda are typically called as eigenvalues, and that particular characteristic equation, this is what is the characteristic equation that I am getting in terms of lambda, which is called as the characteristic equation. And the roots of this lambda are called as eigenvalues. So we get two roots for this particular expression. They are called as eigenvalues, and the corresponding solution vectors xi, right? So now if I substitute the first value of lambda, I'll get one particular vector. This is called as eigenvector. I'll put another value of lambda, I'll get another expression. That is what I'm calling as another eigenvector. So corresponding to different lambdas, I'll get different eigenvectors as well. But instead of doing all this manual way, I can very well use eigen of the matrix, right? So I can simply say eigen of B, I'll get the eigenvalues as well as the eigenvectors. So with the matrix B, so these are the eigenvalues that I'm typically getting, right? So if you just see this, I have the matrix B, which is 5, 8, 9, right? 2, 5, 2, and I have 1, 3, 7 times x1, x2, x3. I have three different variables. I want to see how much times, right, when I'm putting the same x1, x2, x3, what are the different possible values of lambda where the multiplication of this is equal to some scalar times this? So in this case, it is saying there are three possible values for that. One is 12.11. So there is one possibility that lambda is 12.11. There is another possibility that the lambda is 3.53. So this is one possible value of lambda. This is another possible value of lambda. And 1.35 is another possible value of lambda. So what it typically means is, when you are doing, okay, 5x1, right, when you are saying 5x1 plus 8x2 plus 9x3, this is what you are multiplying, it would typically be equal to 12.11x1 plus 12.11x2 plus 12.11x3. So this is one possibility that can come out. And now when you are simplifying the same, it is working out in this particular manner. Right, when you are saying 12.11x1, so this is working out to 5x1, and this is 12.11x1, which will work out to 7x1. Similarly, 4x2 plus 3x3. Similarly, I can put it the other ways also. I can very well simplify the expressions in terms of lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3. And this is what is the kind of solution that I am getting. So for one lambda, it is 12.11. The other one, it is 3.53. So these are my eigenvalues. And these are the eigenvectors. When I am substituting the lambda in this particular equation, these are the typical vectors that I am going to get. So that is how we can simplify the eigenvalues as well as eigenvectors, which have so many applications in the world of finance, business analytics, etc. So computing the eigenvalues, we really need to have a good amount of understanding of that. Then, so there are so many usages, as we have already discussed about. If I want to do a portfolio, if I want to really find out the most optimal value of a portfolio, create a variance covariance matrix, or if I want to extract the principal components from a multi-dimensional data, then the different eigenvalues, so if you see the eigenvalues, this is what is the behavior that they exhibit. They show in a descending order. The first eigenvalue will be much, much higher, then the next kind of stuff. Right? It will give you all the roots of that particular equation, but you will see it in a descending order. This is one more place where the principal components, if I see the overall variation, this is equal to 16 or 12, 13, 15, 16, 17. But out of which 12.11 is contributed by the first one itself. So this will become my principal component, because out of the total variation of the data, this is contributing a most significant portion of it. So that's how the eigenvalues will become more and more helpful for me, eigenvalues and the eigenvectors, to extract the principal components out of the matrix as well. So that's one more area where this concept will become more and more useful. Then, the other important thing we can talk about using matrices is solving a system of linear equation, right? I am talking about, let's say, 3x1 plus 4x2 equal to 10, 5x1 plus 6x2 equal to 14. Now, based on this, I want to find out my values of x1 and x2. So, this could be extended to any number of variables. I am just giving a two variable kind of a scenario. So, if I am able to express this in the form of one matrix, this is A. The matrix B is x1, x2 is equal to 10, 14. So, I can write this in a matrix form like this. All the coefficients in one matrix, all the variables in one matrix, all the results in one matrix, making it AX equal to B. In this case, X is nothing but A inverse B. If I want to really find out X1, X2, it is nothing but A inverse multiplied by B. The same logic I can very well give using this function called solve. Solve as a function directly computes the inverse, directly solves the system of linear equations for me, where I have to specify the matrix and I have to specify, so it will give me the inverse, it will compute the inverse matrix internally. So I have to specify the coefficients in a form of a matrix A, and at the same time I have to give the constant, which is a kind of a vector. I have to give in terms of a vector, in terms of a column matrix. Right here I have to give it as a column vector. So probably the same solution, let me try. So M1 I am calling it, which is the matrix 1. I am setting it in the form of a matrix, wherein my variables I have to give in columnar form 3, 5, 4, 6. And I'll say n row equal to 2, because based on that it will compute the number of columns. So my matrix M1 is becoming 3, 4, 5, 6, which is what is this one. And I have to give another matrix, which is M2, which is my solution, which are nothing but my known values. So I'm giving one square matrix A containing the coefficients I have already given now. I have to give a column vector KV containing the known values. So this is what I am calling M2. I am calling it as a matrix containing 10, 14. Right? And I will say n row equal to 2. Because it's a columnar vector, 2 rows, 1 column kind of a matrix. So M2 is coming out to be 10, 14. Now I can simply use the solve. M1, M2. M1 is the matrix of the coefficients. M2 is a columnar matrix of the known values. So based on that, when I am solving, it is saying that x1 value is minus 2, y1 is x2 is 4. So it's as good as saying 3 into minus 2 plus 4 into 4 should be equal to 10. 16 minus 6 is 10. 5 into minus 2 plus 6 into 4, 24 minus 10 is 14. So this is solving my linear equations and giving me the values of x1 and x2. Even that, one of the things which we used to do with pen and paper very heavily, and that becomes very complicated if we are using more than 3-4 variables, solving those kind of equations become more and more difficult. Probably the best way to solve those kind of equations is using the matrix methods itself. So in the real world, there are so many such kind of applications that exist with the matrices. So it's better that I understand solving all these kinds of aspects using different kinds of tools itself, rather than focusing on the pen and paper way of solving the same. Then, once we are done with the matrices part, I want to just quickly introduce you to the aspects of calculus which can be done with R. Different kinds of rules of differentiation and integration are known to R, right? When you are saying d by dx of x to the power of n, R knows it that it is n into x to the power of n minus 1. Or if you want to say I want to find derivative of e power x, it says yes, it is e power x itself. Or if you want to say I want to find it to a to the power of x, it says it is a to the power of x log a. Sometimes we may have, sometime back, we might have mucked up all these kinds of differentiation formulas to do these derivatives. But today, when I am using R, I really don't need to remember all these things. I can really use them in my modeling because there are so many applications of differentiation, right? I want to do a maxima and a minima. Another major application of differentiation used in multiple fields. Optimization problems all require the usage of differentiation in some form or the other. And if you see, the function that we are using is a simple D, D for differentiation. D is the name of the function which can do a lot of differentiation problems for us. And the way you are doing any of the problems is, you give it as an expression, whatever you want to give, 2x cube. Whatever you want to give, you give it and specify you want to do a differentiation with respect to what. So it is nothing but d by dx of 2x cube. So it will have to compute it as 6x squared. So let's see if it can do that. D times expression, I have to give it as 2 into x cube. And I have to take the derivative of it with respect to x. So I have to close it. Two into expression x cube, and I'm taking the derivative of it with respect to x. Okay, let me just take x squared with respect to x. So let me look at the D question mark, why it is giving me the error. Okay, expression and name. I'm giving expr, okay. I am giving something like this. D I can take double derivatives, etc. But let me take a very simple case. I'm giving an expression d of, or I can use derivative of expression, but here I'm giving expression and the name. And the name here is the character vector giving the variable with respect to which the derivative will be computed. We have already given that. Okay, in expression, I did not enclose it in brackets. Okay, expression of x squared. This expression I have to enclose it in brackets. Expression of x squared comma x. Okay, this is where I made a mistake. Alright. So derivative of expression of x squared with respect to x gives me 2x. Now I can do all the derivatives now. So instead of x squared within the bracket, let me put 3x squared, 3 into x squared. So I'll get it as 3 into 2 into x. right? Or I can now put even slightly complex ones. Instead of 3 into x squared, let me put e power x, which will say that e to the power of x log e. Similarly, if I put, right, I'll put some complex expression, 2 into x squared plus 3 into x plus 5. When I want to put the derivative for this, it says 2 into 2 into x plus 3. Similarly, if I put even the trigonometric functions, right, sine of x plus cos of x. It says cos of x minus sine of x. So you can give different kinds of expressions here, right? Tan of x divided by x squared. So this is how it computes. So even the UV rules, multiplication formulas, division formulas, lot of these things can very well be computed in R. That becomes the quite comfort. Even if I'm not that comfortable by using the differentiation, I can very well use the D formula of R to perform the differentiation for me. Similarly, I can go ahead with the integration also. So for that, I just need to use a function called integrate. Right, all the functions which are, especially it can do the definite integrals quite comfortably. If I want to do an integration, let's say, I say integrate. Right, let me just give you the function integrate. So it says integrate f, which is a function, right, whatever is the name of the function. So you have to specify the lower limits as well as the upper limit, and it will give the actual value of that particular integration. So that is what is being done through the integrate function. So let me say if I am doing integrate x squared between 1 and 3. So I am doing an integrate x squared. I have to give the lower and upper limits. X squared is not a function, character or symbol. An R function taking a numeric first argument and returning the numeric vector. So let me just look at integrate. Okay, it can do only for so I can, if I want, I have to write it as a function, right. Okay, so let me write integrand as a function, right, where I'll write it as function of x. I'll call it as x squared, right, a simple function. I'm writing the function of x as x squared. Then I will do integrate of integrand, comma 1, comma 3. I'll integrate it between 1 to 3. So basically it gives me integration of x squared between 1 and 3, the integration of dx. Integration is x cubed by 3. This is integrated between 3 and 1. 3 cubed is 27 by 3, 9, minus 1 cubed by 3 is 1 by 3. So which becomes 8.667 kind of stuff. That is what is being provided through this integration. So if I have to do it with respect to x's, I have to first create a function and save the value as a part of the function and then use the integrand as a part of the integrate formula. But otherwise, if I already have regular functions, let's say integrate, I can do the integration of any probability density functions between minus infinity to plus infinity. If I am doing integrating the PDF of the probability density function associated with a normal distribution, which is D norm, it says that the integrated value is equal to 1. Similarly, instead of D norm, you do it for some other distribution, let's say D gamma. right? Here, okay, I have to specify the shape. So the shape is missing with no default. So I have to give some kind of a shape for the gamma distribution. I have to give all the variables associated with the gamma distribution. Right, once I give the variable values, I are probably d exponent. Let me try the exponential distribution. Even here, I think I have to give the shape parameter, but no, it is taking the value, it is taking the integral between minus infinity to plus infinity. But let's say I am doing it instead of minus infinity to plus infinity, if I am doing it only between 0 to infinity, then also it is giving 1, which means the exponential function is defined only for positive values. Then instead of infinity, let's say I set it up to 10. Then it says this value is 0.99. So which means in an exponential function, getting a value above 10, the probability is just 0.0001. So there are some such kind of quick integrations that we can work out using the PDF functions of different probability distributions. The most common application is if I have some kind of integrals in the form of x, create them in the form of functions and then use your integrate function specifying the lower and the upper limits for the same. So you can try different kinds of probability distributions. You can try integrating them to get your very well comfortable kind of results. Even the differential equations, especially the ordinary differential equations, which manually when you are doing the numerical methods wise, you are using the Runge-Kutta method, you can very well integrate them using the dsolve package. Of course, when we are taking up those kind of examples at a later point, especially when you are using, when you are solving a few financial formulas which are using the differential equations as the base, we can very well discuss this dsolve package. But I just want to give you some kind of a quick input that even these kind of aspects nowadays are possible to be solved through R. That's the kind of breadth that R is offering. Earlier, more packaged tools, more priced and expensive tools like MATLAB has to be used for doing all these activities. But with R, it becomes even more simpler for doing all these activities more and more quickly. So this is what I wanted to bring about, the basic mathematical and calculus related things which you can solve through R. If you have any further queries regarding the same, you can get back to me by giving me a call on the number that I have given below, or you can send in an email at vamsidhar@pacegurus.com. Thanks a lot for listening to this session. Thank you very much.